regional conflicts. And we all know that is climate action is really needed, but we all know that climate action need to be in a context, in a broader context of sustainability, looking at the three dimensions of sustainability, so social, economic, and environmental one. So I will start. I know that the panelists we have different skills, knowledges. They come from a different sector. So I think they can provide to us a broad range of perspective toward this topic. And I would start with the first speaker I have on my list, that is Todd Crane, is a principal scientist at the ILRI, so the International Livestock Research Institute based in Nairobi in Kenya. And I know that you, Todd, are a social scientist, and you probably have a specific angle, no, of, as researcher on this. And one of the question probably to start up a little bit the discussion is about this discussion on livestock that we are having in the context of climate change. And might be this really a good example to start the discussion on unintended consequences. So why do you think, for example, there are proposals not to increase the consumption of plant protein? How do you feel that shifting totally diets toward consuming more plant protein and replace animal source food might really have an impact and could affect other dimension?
Okay, thank you. I see we're jumping in with the really big question straight away, straight in the deep end. Yeah, of course, the answer to this question of what would be the unintended consequences, any intervention like that, consequences will vary across the systems, across the different locations where it's done, and the time scale at which that transition occurred. I will put a caveat on my responses that I do focus exclusively on African livestock systems in my research, so that's where my experience comes from. I would say one of the very immediate, you know, if we woke up in the morning and the livestock had all disappeared overnight, in Africa, we would see a great deal of malnutrition because it does fulfill a nutrition niche that is not easily met otherwise. An often overlooked aspect in analyzing livestock systems in Africa is to look beyond this as a milk or a meat production, that animals, livestock in much of Africa serve a variety of functions. They aren't just for, even in the dairy systems, it's not just for milk production. The animals are for manure production, which is for soil fertility maintenance. The animals are used for exchange. Animals are kept for traction as a part of the livestock system. So we would lose animal traction, which is heavily relied upon still in many places. We would lose manure as an essential input to integrated farming systems. Livestock are also very important in social exchange. You can't get married until you give livestock away to your future. As a man, you can't get married till you give livestock away to your future father-in-law. This is very important in many places. And you can't replace that with cash. It's not well looked upon to try and do an equal cash value. The animals are the thing. So it's, I think I'm really trying to emphasize that we need to understand multifunctionality of livestock and appreciate the knock-on effects that this would have. The nutritional component is essential, I think, especially for the first 1,000 days of a child's life. We see that especially milk and, once they're old enough, meat products give nutritions and micronutrients that are otherwise often difficult to get based in diets that are not exceedingly diverse. And the developmental effect of not having access to those nutrients in the first 1,000 days plays out through really the course of a person's life in terms of their cognitive capacities, ability to profit from education, ability to learn, etc. So that nutrient input at that critical stage of child development would risk being lost. Boy, this question flies off in so many directions.
You can take one that you prefer if you have other things that you want to add.
I think
I think it's already, so one point that I think is quite relevant from what you said is that it's important to think to global policies, but then also how they can fit in the local context, no?
Right.
So for example, the social importance of livestock in Africa is for sure something that should, taken into account, no, on any policies you can take and implement on the ground. But I think Todd is good as first input for the conversation. Sure. So we can move to Michelle Nutting. Michelle, you lead the agriculture and environmental sustainability department of Nutrien. So a big fertilizer company. And I know that this you have made a commitment, no, in terms of climate change policies, and you want to reduce the emission by 30% by 2030. So do you think that, for example, this commitment that your company is taking will have some effects in terms of reducing productivity, efficiency, yields?
Thanks very much for the question. And thank you for including me today in this panel discussion. I feel like I'm among friends when I'm here, being with a group that is very focused on agriculture. So let me start by addressing the commitment that Nutrien has made. And for those in the room that don't know Nutrien, we're one of the world's largest nutrient providers to farmers. We do everything that a farmer needs to grow a good crop, including we manufacture about 27 million tons of fertilizer, potash, nitrogen, phosphates. So when we talk about making a 30% emission reduction by 2030, our very specific goal is regarding our scope 1 and 2 emissions. So the operations that come from within our operational footprint, and reduce that by 30% by 2030. Some may feel that that is not ambitious enough, but you have to understand nitrogen fertilizer production and the technology limitations and the chemistry to understand that that is a very ambitious goal by 2030. And that is just the start for Nutrien. We are looking at all of the new technology deployment, including carbon capture and storage, as well as electrolyzing or hydrolyzing the electricity grid so that we can have clean energy to produce nitrogen with as well. So I think some context is important. First, let's say that as a company, we know that we have a big role to play to reduce our own emissions. And we also are looking at then the emissions that come from fertilizer use on farms. And if you looked at our total carbon footprint, you would find that about 70% of our emissions occur as a result of the application of nitrogen fertilizer on farms. So I'd like to give a specific example of some approach in policy that is meant to help us reduce emissions from fertilizer use, but may have some of those unintended consequences that you've talked about. So the Canadian government, and for context, I'm Canadian and I'm going to use a Canadian example, but Nutrien actually operates in North America as well as South America, so very relevant for this group. The Canadian example I'm about to give is the Canadian federal government's target to reduce emissions from fertilizer application on the field by an absolute goal of 30%. So not an intensity goal, but an absolute emission reduction of 30% by 2030 from the application of fertilizer on fields. The types of emissions that come from fertilizer application on fields, from nitrogen particularly, are nitrous oxides, which we can affect with nitrogen management practices, and carbon dioxide, which is contained within the urea molecule. So when urea is applied, the CO2 is assumed 100% to be released. And that is an emission that we cannot mitigate with management practice change. So that's one challenge, is there's a portion of emissions that is not mitigatable, if you will, as a word. And then the second challenge in this is that they've set it as an absolute cap. So what that means is today in Canada, the only measurement method that the government uses to determine what the amount of emissions are from fertilizer is they look at the rate of fertilizer applied and the environmental characteristics of the region in which it's applied. If the only lever that a farmer has to reduce nitrous oxide emissions is to reduce the rate of fertilizer application, that means they actually have to reduce the rate of application to reduce emissions. And that wasn't really the intention of the government. But I think when they came out, environment came out with the policy without talking to ag. So there's another challenge right there, is there's a lack of communication between those two departments within the government. And there's been significant comment given back to both agriculture and the environment departments to say, these are the challenges, the unintended consequences that you've created. And I think to the government's credit, they have really listened and understood that their quantification method needs to be updated. And here's the third challenge in agriculture. Farmers are the most innovative, and they are very much leaders. When new technology comes out, they are willing to test and try on farm. And the body of science that's required to substantiate to the degree required by IPCC is in new development. When you've got innovative products, you don't have the same size of a body of knowledge that gives high certainty as to what the outcome is from the implementation of that practice. So we do have to move towards a little bit more accepting of risk around the uncertainty that's in the science, and knowing that we are moving in a directionally correct manner, and that uncertainty level is going to reduce over time. So there's some challenges there, but in Canada, and this applies globally, so not just affecting nitrogen rate to reduce emissions, but also looking at management practices like, are we placing all of the nitrogen fertilizer in a band below the surface? And this is applicable. It doesn't matter where you farm and what your technology level is. Subsurface banded nitrogen application can be done in microdosing in developing countries, and it can be done with very sophisticated variable rate fertilizer applicators that apply all the fertilizer and the seed subsurface at the same time. But the research that substantiates what the outcomes of that are is not quite developed. So that's one practice. Other practices are the use of enhanced efficiency fertilizers that will also reduce the amount of nitrous oxide that's evolved. But again, the research isn't quite there to say that with the high degree of certainty required, that that is going to have an effect. So as I said, we're starting to have some better conversations about innovation and accepting more innovative products and practices to reduce nitrous oxide emissions. But in this environment of urgent need and high ambition, I think sometimes that bar of what is acceptable in terms of science is set so high that we're going to miss the adoption of innovative practices that can also deliver benefits. So I think that's kind of my opening comments, and I'll certainly turn it to the next panelist unless you have some questions.
No, I think it's very interesting also from a very generalist perspective what you said, because I thought about the interplay between science, innovation, farmers, and also how these different actors interact together, no? For taking part in partnerships. So farmers with scientists, and we have a researcher here, a farmer, so we can explore later this. But yeah, I will pass to Thomas. So Thomas Westhoff here is coming as president of one big international organization regrouping students in agriculture-related science. Thomas is also an expert in peatland and also in food waste. So probably you want to take these two angles to give some opening remarks on the main problem.
Yeah, thank you very much. And thanks a lot for inviting me. So I want to connect a bit the dots here and look at unintended consequences. After the invention of the windmill in the country where I come from, the Netherlands, because we invented the windmill there, we could drain peatlands. And draining peatlands, although 3% of the world is covered in peatland, it contains twice as much carbon as all forests combined. So let that sink in. It's a major carbon stock. And while we were draining peatlands, the rotting started of these peatlands. Cattle came in because we could only produce grass there. And that's why Gouda cheese is so famous, or Gouda, maybe you know it better as Gouda in English, but the right pronunciation is Gouda, because Gouda is a little village in the midst of peatlands, and it has seen a gigantic transformation in the last thousands of years after the invention, because the drainage created the dairy production there, and the cheese went all across the globe, and the market in Gouda was the main location for the cheese trade. But it has had a lot of unintended consequences too, because in the Netherlands now no building can be built because we have a big nitrogen crisis, because we have so much cattle. If you buy bacon in the UK, it comes from the Netherlands. We are producing, and there are more chickens than humans in the Netherlands. Well, we have 18 million people in the Netherlands, and it's one of the most densely populated countries in Europe. So I think we are having a lot of unintended consequences with the current policies in place too, because with the common agricultural policy in the European Union, there was a lot of action on more efficiency, producing more. And we see now the consequences there. To move back to the discussion around what it has to do with climate then, for the peatlands, there has been a plan. We should reduce the emissions from peatlands heavily towards 2030. 3.8 megatons should be reduced. And in that sense, there has been a lot of work on that. But farmers have to change then. Dairy production on peatlands is unsustainable. So in that sense, people have to think about how to move further, creating polluticulture, for example, in which you grow cranberries or other forms of production, have not been widely adopted, because the consequences of current policies are that, for example, the European Union doesn't invest and doesn't give subsidies to such farming practices. I think there are a lot of unintended consequences with the current policies too. And I think it's very important to look into a generational approach, because in my work, I thought about transformative pathways inside the Dutch peatlands. And I think we should look more and more into new farmers, because as we all know, the average age of farmers is very high, and there will become a new generation of farmers. And I think it's good to ask ourselves, how does a new generation of farmers want to farm? And I see a lot of interest in my student association in sustainable practices. And I think we should make more the shift if one farm moves to another farm, make the resources available to also try to transform these farms then, and invest more heavily in a new generation that wants to make these changes and maybe wants to move from dairy production towards polluticulture production. I followed the Coranivia discussions. I'm very disappointed that we again don't have any conclusions, and it's moved to next COP. So I hope it will change, but I'm afraid that may not be the case. And I think it's very important that we look into a food systems approach there. And in one of my works in EIS is, for example, preventing food waste, because I think that's something we can all agree on. We should prevent food waste, and consumers have also a big role to play there. And I invite everyone here to come to my university, Wageningen University, where in the Netherlands, where I'm organizing in January, together with all other students, a big conference on that in rethinking waste. And I think there the food systems approach will come forward very clearly there. And to give one example that may, where one of my members are working on, it's called AcoFresh. It's an innovator from Ghana, and together with a partnership with the FAO, he could have trainings from us, and he's doing a great job. He was here in the first week too, and he's creating a solution for food losses. So in Ghana, there are a lot of places which are not connected to the electricity grid. So he is developing on a large scale all kind of cooling systems to make sure farmers are not losing their production, and all powered by solar panels. So yeah, maybe a next generation doesn't want a cow for when they are marrying, but want a product from AcoFresh, one of those solar powered cooling systems. So yeah, that may be a consequence of a change in thinking. And I think a generational approach is often missing here. And it's sad to see that in these spaces at COP, it's all happening behind closed doors, and youth has not been involved that much. I've tried hard with my association to go into informal meetings to try to get out there, but it's sad to see there is so much underrepresentation, but I'm happy to be represented in this panel at least.
And I thank you also for providing a little bit of links with this parallel discussion and what is actually really happening not very far from here, but is the negotiation meeting rooms where they in this moment are trying to discuss what future of agriculture and agricultural discussion will be in the UNFCCC. But we can come back on this point probably later. Let me introduce Eiji Kawamura, that is a leading farm leader. Kawamura is a former secretary of the California Department of Agriculture, in addition to be a farmer right now. And his works involve a creative land reuse and support of nutrition programs in his region. So I think, AG, you can have plenty of experience and expertise to represent a bit the farmers that are in the front line of climate change, for sure. And you may want to share with us some of your work that you are leading right now, that dealing with climate change and how to deal with adaptation and mitigation option.
Certainly. Thank you, Fabio. And special thanks to Emerging Ag and AICA for the opportunity to really discuss some great points and important points here at this conference. This idea that we have unintended consequences, that seems to be a theme for conference after conference after conference. And more importantly, I think this is maybe a good example of how we start talking about intended consequences, because we start to recognize that we have to work together, not in silos. And this idea that agriculture had its own special day on Saturday, pretty amazing. The fact that we're talking about nutrition insecurity instead of just food insecurity, you start to see that there's a lot of progress being made in how we embrace the ag endeavor, if you will. The fact that agriculture activity was easily checked off as an essential part of work that needs to be done during the pandemic. Was that an unintended consequence or a really predictable consequence that the essential endeavor that agriculture is actually pretty important? And you would have thought years ago at the original COPs that they didn't understand that agriculture was important, but certainly even behind closed doors, you start to see there's a lot of leaders that are starting to recognize, for example, with the sustainable development goals, you can't accomplish them if agriculture is doing poorly on this planet. And then you start looking at the goals individually, and whether it's livestock, whether it's the soil and the soil health and the nutrients that we're trying to use, whether it's youth learning about food systems and natural systems, whether it's about the climate, these are all interrelated. Yesterday, we talked about water. Without all these components working together, you start to see the system fall apart. And I think that's why we're all here today, is we need to understand the system's dynamic. It's complex, more importantly than complex, it's understandable with the tools we have today, let alone the tools that are coming along for tomorrow. When we look at where I farm, I'm a farmer, I'm an urban farmer is what some people will call me, but actually I'm a farmer in an urban area where we were farming in 60 years ago, the county I was farming in, Orange County, everybody knows in California where Disneyland is, 60 years ago, that county was one of the top producing counties in America. Today, with all the urbanization, there's a very small amount of agriculture left that you would recognize, but there's opportunities for agriculture indoors, on a rooftop, in a park. There's all kinds of ways we can produce food. We can produce edible landscapes. In fact, I have a local nonprofit. We like to say it's edible landscapes everywhere, so there's hunger nowhere. And that same nonprofit started out by gleaning our agricultural fields in the area. And now we're actively producing food for food banks. And just for the last 25 years, instead of 4 acres a year, custom growing food for a food bank for the nutritionally insecure, used to be food insecure, but for 20 years, 30 years, we were doing these small scales. And because of the pandemic, an unintended consequence was that there were tremendous people coming to the food banks because they were out of jobs, out of food. And the food banks were saying, I wish you guys could grow more food. And someone asked, well, why do you guys grow 4 acres? Why don't you grow 40 acres? Why isn't it 400 acres? And so this last year, we went from 5 acres basically to 50 acres just by thinking that this is something that can be done. We have resources to reallocate. We can realign those resources. And overnight, basically, in fact, a year later, with 6,000 volunteers and help from a food bank paying for food, we delivered 2.7 million pounds of fresh produce every week to the food bank. And how simple that was, because in every country, we have land resources that are sitting idle. We have water availability. We have plenty of talent, plenty of retired farmers that would love to teach young people how to farm again. We have all the ingredients to just kind of rethink things. And that's what we say about this unintended consequences of climate change. It has to stimulate our imagination, because without new imagination in a new century, we're just going to be stuck in the 20th century. But we want to get out of that 20th century and into this 21st century. And that's why we like to call it, it's a renaissance that's taking place, because just 100 years ago, we know people that were born 100 years ago that in their early teens were using horses to plow their fields. They're alive today. How fast we've come in such a short amount of time. Where will we be in the next 10, 20 years? And this idea that we cannot accomplish those sustainable development goals is not true. We can accomplish them by the year 2030 if we have the will and the imagination to do it. And we certainly have the capacity. But without the will and the imagination, it's not going to happen. And with that will and imagination is why a panel like this, we get a chance to bring together different ideas and different thinking and reintroduce, I guess, this thought that agriculture has to be the center of these kind of changes, the center of a renaissance that might take place. And we're really excited about that right now. There's solutions to be had.
And I think one of the points that you made is that unintended consequences also require a great deal of creativity to try to face them, and also a great deal of capacity to do collaboration and to start collaboration with different organization and stakeholders in all the private sector, research, farmers. That can really provide new ideas and try to make synergies. One of the things that probably we may want to try to explore a little bit together in the next phase of this event is about this interplay between what you represent. So you are a farmer, you taught a researcher, you, Michelle, are a manager in the private sector. You are a young activist, president of an association, and also a researcher on your own. But what is why you think that your work and what you are doing need from what they are trying to do in here? So, what what kind of outcome or what kind of decision for you might be useful in this context and that could help you in doing what you already are doing? It's very difficult to speak about concrete decision at a very international level. So we have to take into account of the differences, cultural, political, that there are. But we always say that what is decided at the UN level then is super important because all the national dimension take this guidance and try to contextualize in their local context. But what might be, so what are your concrete expectations from the kind of decision negotiators at UNFCCC level can take in discussing agriculture? What can be really useful for you and your work? I don't know, Thomas, who wants to start? I think it's a big question. Todd, you started for first.
Yeah, very good question. I would say giving perspective. I was also in Rome during the Committee on Food Security at the 50th edition. And there I was happy to see that for the first time a declaration for youth was accepted. Unfortunately, not on women. And that's something I hope will be soon, at least at the next one. Very disappointed to see that. But it gives hope because member states should act, should involve more youth in creating food security. And I think having here a decision on Coronivia, which I still hope will pass, gives perspective to young farmers who want to make that next leap, that to more sustainable systems, give member states, oblige member states to think about how to look at the next generation of agriculture, how to involve them. So I see it as giving perspective because it will unlock in countries, hopefully, if countries are following here the promises they make, yeah, new opportunities for young people. And in that sense, I really hope to see generational shift here taking place. And giving those opportunities.
Michelle?
Thought-provoking question. So when I think about what I would like to see coming out of this discussion, first of all, is one of the challenges I mentioned, which is solving the environment climate doesn't lie merely with the environment departments of governments. And I think from my perspective in the agriculture industry, agriculture is nature, it's science-based, and it really needs to be at the table with the governments when they're talking to their environment departments about how to solve the challenges. So I would like there to be much more cooperation amongst departments at the government level in solving the challenge. And I think also for me, what I'm hearing and being influenced by in a lot of the pavilions here this week is people are looking for very context-specific prescriptive practices sometimes when it comes to agriculture. And I'd like to see much more an outcomes-focused approach, which is science-based. So if you determine the outcome that you're trying to achieve in terms of greenhouse gas or water or biodiversity for the area, then I think that frameworks need to be much less prescriptive about practices because prescription and practices can set up friction between different kinds of farming systems. And that's not the intention. Wasting time talking about frictions between farming systems isn't helping solve the problem. So I think having science-based and outcomes-focused approaches then allows for a wide kind of flexible adoption within each area for how to achieve our challenges regarding not only the environment, the climate, but also water and biodiversity.
I'd like to actually expand, I think, on the two previous responses, is that especially in the climate change realm, we tend to be organizing a lot around technical targets, reducing emissions rates, maintaining productivity under certain modeled conditions. It's easy to lose sight as we organize around very technical targets that we're talking about people's livelihoods. That, yes, we can achieve a reduced emissions intensity in where I work at, say, the Kenya dairy system, but that will likely create unintended consequences if we don't pay attention to them and explore those tensions as we go. For example, our recent research has been showing that in a lot of places, to reduce emissions intensities, of course, we're looking at intensification. Intensification, however, tends to come on the back of women's unpaid labor in households. It tends to come with them being disenfranchised in some cases from their income streams, because commercialization tends to shift money into men's financial spaces. This is something we've seen. It's not what anyone's been trying to do, but if we only look at the emission intensity target, that's being achieved. But we're looking at some fairly social, negative social impacts that will create knock-on effects themselves. So really attending to not just achieving the technical targets, but understanding the socioeconomic targets, the social inclusion targets that are found in the SDGs and elsewhere. And then creating mechanisms to try and build synergy there where there isn't necessarily a natural synergy to be found, and potentially even to explore trade-offs. Is it worth it to optimize the reduction in emission intensity? Or can we say, well, we're willing to dial back that target if we can maintain a dairy sector that is inclusive of, creates opportunities for women to make a living or to maintain their own independent income streams. So again, this is another potential unintended consequence, but it can be dealt with if we create and organize around the metrics that hold us to those outcomes, rather than creating or treating them as kind of a knock-on effect, as a secondary consideration.
Yes. Before you, AJ, may keep on this discussion on what are your expectations on the outcomes of the negotiation, probably I can introduce last panelist, but had some previous engagement, so was a little bit delayed. Tabi Yoda is an award-winning indigenous agroforester, author, and eco-entrepreneur. He works principally on local communities, forest restoration, ecosystem resilience, and value chain development. And I think you can add to this short introduction. And to give you a little bit of the background of the conversation, we started to try to address this topic of unintended consequences that mitigation and adaptation measure may have. And then we ended also to try to make a link between this conversation and the conversation that is happening right now on the future of the discussion on agriculture in the UNFCCC. I don't know if you want to just introduce a little bit your thinking about this overall topic of unintended consequences that may have and mitigation and adaptation measure based on your experience. I know that you also have a big a project of reforestation in place. And then we can restart with AG.
Thank you very much. And really sincere apologies for this delay. I think technology sometimes fails us. And I was guided by simplicity. I had to ask the cleaner in the corridor, do you know where this hall is? And then he gave me a clue of this location. That is to say, no solution is never too much, or never, you know, or no solution should be kept out of the discussions, even right here, as we are discussing on this unintended consequences of, you know, adaptation and mitigation. And I come from the Sahel region of Africa, and I have worked principally on the landscape where I engage communities. And something very strikingly that you like to know is the co-benefiting sharing or co-benefiting working mechanism that we created in 47 communities in the Sahel around the Lake Chad, where pastoralists who have previously lived in very conflicting conditions, highly risk laden communities with a lot of lack, with a lot of adversities, with a lot of dryness, are now able to work together, farmers and pastoralists who never saw each other with the eyes, can now co-live through these co-benefiting solutions that we created through restoration of the landscape using agroforestry and indigenous knowledge techniques, like restoring pasture fields, restoring agroforestry land systems, and also bringing an indigenous ecosystem or land governance aspect, which most governments don't have in their laws. That is something very, very key that I will perhaps, even before I go into discussing very deeply, for stakeholders to consider that communities have elements of knowledge systems that, if well looked at and harnessed, they can constitute sources of enhancing adaptation and mitigation in scale. So some of the results of our work is 3.7 million trees. I think Lufingo here knows some of those information, well documented. 3.7 million trees planted, and over 400 landscapes restored, and the creation of 1,550 land-based jobs created for women and women. However, when I meant the co-benefiting, this is some of the social benefits from that co-benefiting ecosystem. So in terms of the unintended consequences, I just wanted, I'm not a very good English speaker. I speak more of my local language, but permit me to make mistakes as I speak in saying that so much of this conversation is not considering the elements of ordinary life where those on the front line actually live. What's happening to natural ecosystem services that most of the communities depend on? They are depleting. They are actually degrading. But as these degradations, physical degradations are happening, they're degrading even the psyche of the people, making people even more violent. These are unintended consequences that come from some of these decisions. However, do you think that the access to well water or access to natural springs that are getting dry is important in this conversation? For me, it's very important, but these wells are drying up. This natural spring that the critical mass of community depends on are drying off, and the access to viable productive agricultural land is getting more and more scarce, and it's creating this whole set of, you know, physical landscape degradation and human dignity degradation that is connecting and interplaying with the critical state of poverty and, you know, food insecurity and other unintended consequences now to even fuel violences that we are seeing, and also create, you know, climate-driven migration. Like, for in my context, we have received over 700 young people back from Libya in the last 6 years. They wanted to travel to Italy or to Europe through the Mediterranean, but some of them died on the way. Some of them came back. Those who came back, we have to also understand what is the influence of climate in their lives, and what are they currently doing? Do they become easy recruits to violent groups, armed groups in the region? These are unintended consequences. So some of these intended consequences, I think, really need to be looked at. I don't know if I am very clear about what I'm sharing in terms of my own perception or understanding of unintended consequences. But the local woman in the community who lives on fetching firewood from the natural trees and burning it to cook food needs to do that continuously every day, because it is that food that keeps her and her family living. But we want these trees to be preserved, to be conserved and to be protected. But how much are we looking at, you know, the processes of getting this really done in such a way that if they have to, you know, if they have to have an economic cost or perhaps an opportunity cost, what will be the alternative that makes them not to deplete or not to continue to live or survive on these natural ecosystem services that you and I need? We need these trees, we need the wetlands, we need the entire forest, you know, ecosystem or forest biodiversity. But they have to live on this. As a result, they have to brush it down. Not that they love to destroy it, but it is the way of life that, you know, makes them live in that way. So these are unintended consequences that we need to look at. And for us to look at, we need a holistic approach. Like I said earlier, communities actually have elements of knowledge systems that if embraced and harnessed, they can inform, you know, decision on how to conserve, on how to even build stronger, you know, mitigation and adaptation actions that in the long run mitigate these unintended consequences on one side, and on the other be able to catalyze microeconomic systems in the communities that creates unintentionally also jobs for these vulnerable young people, jobs for women, income streams for these women through viable microeconomic actions such as agroforestry development, and even the reviving of biodiversity, reviving of ecosystem, like what we are doing. So just to put in and to conclusion, perhaps in the interest of time, most importantly, is that knowledge system from the community is very key. Looking at the approach with which we engage in mitigation and adaptation is very key. It must be feasible to communities themselves. If we put too much technology, like people say technology, I was actually displaced by technology, you know, to find this location. It took me like 30 minutes to get to this location. Imagine a local woman in the community who doesn't even understand how to use a cell phone. You're already expecting them to use an app to measure maybe the amount of carbon that they emit or the food waste that they incur every day. So we need to be deliberate with policies that have, you know, this capacity to deliver on enhancing the dignity of people so that every job, every income, every access to resource, and every perhaps living condition is actually wrapped in dignity that helps the people to be able to be productive members or productive parts of playing productive part of mitigation and adaptation. Adaptation cannot exist in isolation. Mitigation will not exist in isolation. We need a complete psyche of people who are not disturbed by climate nuisances. So that means policy should actually look at the frontline or climate frontline, you know, versions or understanding what are the natural conditions of these people. However, also look at adopting what we are doing in the Sahel, not just planting trees. So many organizations and many donor agencies are putting money in planting trees. This is not a solution. Why are you planting the trees? For whom are you planting the trees? And what are the kind of trees are you planting? Where are you planting them? How are you monitoring them? How are you nurturing them? Who is doing that? For what end? That's the big question. For what end? So if conversations and negotiations are going on and on and on, we will never get to a good, maybe common ground without addressing these community needs that I'm actually putting through these questions. Because you plant a tree in the name of restoring a land, but that woman is cutting that tree because she wants to use wood. She needs that wood. You and I, we all need life. but these are the realities in the Sahel. So, but governments across the world are investing so much in arms that they're not investing enough in deliberate resilience, the community-centric resilience initiatives or ecosystem-based solutions that provide that are tenable. I call it tenable and viable opportunities that could catalyze what I mentioned earlier, microeconomic and social benefits and opportunities for rural communities. If you bring a gun to a community in the name of providing security, you have only provided insecurity. But thank you very much.
I have to interrupt you, but it was a really rich intervention, and you provided a lot of points to further discuss together. I regret you really arrived with some delays because your input were fantastic and I think it would benefit this discussion. But I wanted to, so we have less than 10 minutes. But I wanted to give you, AG, the possibility to comment if you want to the intervention of Tabi. And I think this importance of community involvement, no, in decision and considering in the big decision the human being, but then are affected by that.
Certainly, and in many ways, the conversation that was moving this way and then coming over here was perfect because they actually can bookend two sides of the challenges that we have. This idea that you have adaptation and then you have mitigation. For many of us in the farm community, mitigation immediately means regulation, means someone prescriptively telling you, this is how you're going to farm because we know better or somebody thinks better. Adaptation, on the other hand, involves volunteerism. Adaptation involves trial and error. Adaptation involves recognizing what works and watching it work and then adapting it. I'm a late adopter to irrigation systems. We were furrow irrigating and then we were sprinklers. And then we looked over the fence and saw our neighbors had drip irrigation and we realized that they were doing better than we were. And so we eventually changed and gained many different benefits of water use efficiency. But this idea, the idea that there's plenty of examples, proof of concepts going all over the world on how do you do reforestation correctly? How do you do urban community farm to food bank programs correctly or in a way that are working that can be easily replicated and then scaled up? I think that's what we're talking about. What can you replicate? What can you scale up? I think we're kind of all of us, I think we recognize that we have to move on beyond the thinking. We like to put it this way. No more think tank, let's do the do tank. Let's start to take in region after region, commodity group after commodity group. It's not one size fits all. It never will be and it never has been, although some people like to try and push everything into a certain kind of box. And I think that's where our opportunity lies today is find each region, find each set of goals. Oh, the goals happen to be the sustainable development goals. Okay, stick those up there. Which country is going to get there first? Which region is going to get there first? Which region gets to say, we've got these accomplished. Can we help you get to where we need to go? And I think that's where the excitement lies in these next years, in this years of implementation is no more think tank. It's time to do the do tank. Those things that are working and working well, let's replicate, let's scale, and let's make them happen on a level that the world has never seen because we're at a time when the world can respond at a level that we've never seen. We just went through the pandemic as proof of concept that a lot of things can happen and a lot of disruption can happen when you think, oh my God, this is the end, but no, it's just the beginning. And so I'll just hand this back your way, Fabio. This is the beginning of this enormous shift, if you will, of getting that 20th century behind us, embracing the ideas of what the 21st century really can be. And you all know if we were to accomplish those 17 goals in the Sustainable Development Goals, the world would be different. If every country could accomplish those goals, the world would be so different that some of this discussion with Ukraine over there down the road, we wouldn't be having this chance to have to go by them and understand the agony and the tragedy that's taking place because we'd have a different world. Just an observation.
Okay, so I don't think we have time for a proper Q&A, probably just one question from the audience, if there is anyone interested in doing this. Yeah.
All right. My name is Chidiabele, from Director of Center for Climate Change, African University of Science and Technology. Great presentation. I just, my question is straight, and that is, where is the position of education or capacity building for the people? He talked about the people who are not, they don't have alternative and they are asked to adapt. So there is a need for education. And then in all that we discuss also, where is the area of education in all of this? Thank you.
Want to take this?
Yeah, I can reflect on this. My association also connects 100 universities, and I think it's very important that we share knowledge as much as possible. Not all universities are that much collaborative in that, but there are some that really try to set up, for example, massive open online courses. I think that's a good step institutions are taking, but I see more and more interest from companies, from the public sector in capacity building, soft skills, and that's something we try to work on. So I invite all the students in your network to reach out to us. We really try to take the initiative ourselves here, because often our universities are not giving the soft skills trainings we need, but only solely focus on the technical skills. And in that sense, try to create a capacity, try to teach young people how to apply for funding, how to present themselves. And I think we have been successful in that.
David, Todd.
Let me quickly say, education could mean whatever to whoever chooses to use that word. In my own sense of it, I have worked principally with communities for many years. He said something that struck me. Adaptation is volunteerism, is volunteer. So that means education for me means anything that has worked for humans over and over and over for their good, that becomes education, whether it is in the universities, whether it is written in books or not. And let's consider that in the next 10, 20 years, as you see, the climate dialogue is changing, even the way people think. The earlier books did not talk about the consciousness, the human consciousness, the human need to live with nature or to live in harmony with nature. That means the next level of education will be education that is talking about human harmony with nature, which at the end of the day, that is the essence of education. So we need to redefine education in itself to hold the future, or rather to create a future that says knowledge that has worked for humanity or in the good of humanity should be what we call education. That should inform policy. That should inform research. That should inform action at all levels. That's the best of education. And just to conclude, maybe I may not have that chance, let's embrace policies that are meant for enhancement of human dignity. If there is an absence of human dignity in any decision, it is not worth the investment. Thank you.
Thank you to all of you, the panelists. I think our host want to say something as closing remarks. Vice President of AICA, I leave you closing this event.
Sure, grazie, Fabio, and thank you very much to an amazing panel. I think this is a unique pavilion here at the COP. We have the voice of farmers, of research, a major company, youth, gender. Change is happening. Agriculture is at the COP, and people are coming here and they're listening to us. This is the home of sustainable agriculture of the Americas, the first time that we participate like this, and it's been a valuable and enriching position. Agriculture is part of the solution to our climate challenges, and farmers are the answer. They know what they're doing. They need researchers, they need companies, and we need the youth. We have the honor of having the head of the World Farmers Organization with us today, Monsieur Arnaud from France. Farmers are the solution to European policy. So we're on your side here to work with all of you globally to help make farming and agriculture part of the solution to climate change. This was a great panel. I learned a lot, and we're very grateful to Emerging Ag. We've been working with you for a number of years, Robin. You guys do a terrific job advocating on behalf of the people that are actually the doers, the dew tank, the people that are working in the field of agriculture to provide food to 8 billion people around the world very efficiently. So we can make it better. But thank you all for coming here, and thank you for your time, and thank you, Fabio, for moderating it. Excellent. Gracias.
Yeah, surely my right.